So, I want to take another look at this figure to begin with. Now, one of the reasons that I began to think about these sorts of things was because I wanted to understand what it might mean to have a set of values and beliefs, because those two things go together, that would, I guess part of the question was, is it possible to develop a system of belief that's outside of the realm of ideology? You know, because one thing you might claim is that it's all ideology. Any belief system is ideological. And if you develop a belief system that criticizes other belief systems, it just means that you've developed a new ideological stance. And that's a good argument, you know. I can think of a number of ways that it's true. One of the things Nietzsche said in the late 1800s was that if you inhabited a belief system, even a religious system, and you lost faith in it, not only did you lose faith in that system, but you also potentially lost faith in systems themselves. And so it was a meta-collapse in a sense. Not only did you lose your belief, but you lost your belief in beliefs. So you could think of the set of all possible beliefs and then abandoning any hope of relying on those as valid sources of information. So, you know, so that's one perspective, and it's a powerful one. I mean, Nietzsche believed that that was a certain pathway to nihilism, essentially, or perhaps to a reactionary totalitarianism, but it boils down to the same thing. I've been reading this book recently, which the title of I can't remember, unfortunately, but I'll tell it to you after class. It's a critique of certain lines of left-wing ideological thinking, including the existential thought of people like Jean-Paul Sartre and Foucault. And one of the most trenchant critiques of Sartre, because he believes that you sort of have an absolute freedom, that you're destined for freedom, that you're doomed to it in some sense, and that part of your existential journey is to establish an authenticity that's correct for you. But he isn't able really to give any description of what that should be grounded in. And the critic concludes that all Sartre can do is stand outside of any potential belief system and criticize it. And there's nothing in it for anyone as a consequence of that. It's only destructive. Now, it's important to remember with regards to Sartre that he viewed other people to some degree, like the common man, the bourgeoisie, we might say, as the embodiment of non-freedom, of inauthenticity, and also as a barrier to genuine authenticity. So he wasn't willing to give any credence to the utility of normality. But I also think he wasn't able to tolerate the consequences of his own thought, because he was an avid supporter of the Communist Party far after anyone with any reasonable moral sense would have stopped doing that. So Sartre really didn't denounce the Communists until the end of the beginning of the 70s, roughly speaking. He was never a card-carrying Communist, but he was very left-leaning. And, you know, by the 1970s, by the late 60s, by the early 70s, a lot of the evidence about what was going on in Soviet Russia had been in for 30 years, you know. So there was really no excuse for not facing up to that and trying to understand what it meant. And, you know, it would be bad enough if it was just the Soviet Union, but it wasn't. The same sort of thing happened wherever those utopian presuppositions were put into place. And I suppose many of you don't know this, but Pol Pot, who was the Cambodian dictator, was educated at the Sorbonne, and he wrote his thesis I think it was his PhD thesis, although it might have been his master's thesis, on the Marxist doctrine that urban people were parasites on rural people. So he, you know, there's a theory that says that the genuine value is generated purely by labor, and much of that's rural labor, and the cities siphon off excess productive power and are able to parasitize the countryside as a consequence of that, and which is a tremendously non-productive theory. But Pol Pot put it into practice, and so when he went back into Cambodia, he chased everybody out of the cities and killed about 6 million people. So, you know, you can read about that if you want. It's a pretty appalling section of 20th century history, you know, especially when it's the case that he was in it, you know, he was educated in the West and had these presuppositions drummed into him. Well, then there's Foucault, who I have no respect for, by the way. I think I've read a fair bit of Foucault, and I think everything he says is obvious. So, for example, he criticizes the idea of mental illness as a social construct. It's like, well, yeah, obviously. I mean, it's not like psychiatrists and psychologists and mental health professionals who are relatively well-informed haven't known about that since for the last 60 years. I mean, it might be a revelation to people who don't notice that psychiatry, for example, is something like a compromise between the patient, biology, and the social world. You know, I mean, psychiatric ailments often have a biological tilt, but the way they manifest themselves in society is clearly conditioned in very intense ways by the particular conditions obtaining at the point that the person who has that biological predisposition exists. Even whether or not that's pathological can be tilted one way or another by cultural norms. And then, of course, when you're dealing with issues like insurance payment and treatment and hospitalization, obviously you're pulling in all sorts of systems that are by no means purely scientific, but I don't find it a particularly useful critique. It's obvious as far as I'm concerned. And the other thing that Foucault did, I mean, I think this is the typical, especially the French intellectuals' typical sleight of hand once Marxism became, you know, once you were no longer able to call yourself a committed Marxist, because committed Marxism had led to unbelievable brutality, you know, on a scale that had never probably, I think, had never been experienced in the entire history of the planet, at least in terms of its reach and duration. You didn't get to call yourself a Marxist anymore, although there were still people, and you still see them, saying, well, that wasn't real Marxism, which I think is a cop-out of staggering proportions. It usually means, well, if I was the person running the country, that wouldn't have happened. You know, that's the logic behind it. They didn't put the principles into practice properly. It's like, yeah, well, lots of people put the damn principles into practice, and the same thing happened everywhere. So at some point, you have to kind of wonder if there's something wrong with the principles. Anyways, what Foucault did was take the Marxist presupposition that everything was could be boiled down to economics and economic power, and translated it into the idea that everything just boiled down to power, you know, and that the reason that we have institutions is to include and to exclude, and that the institutions always run for the benefit of those at the top. It's like, well, yeah, that's a little bit true, but it's, you know, it's a scientist would look at that and say, yeah, well, probably, you know, power dynamics in a functioning economic and political system maybe account for 10% of the variance, something like that, maybe 15%. So, for example, if you have a, say you want to go to an Ivy League school, well, if your parents went to the school, you're more likely to get in, but you're not that much more likely to get in, and you still have to be, you know, roughly speaking, what happens is that if you have a pretty decent, you know, high school GPA, and you do very well on the SATs, and you have some other talents of some sort, because that's also necessary, then they might pick you over someone else who's roughly equally qualified if you have a familial history of attendance at the school. So obviously you get an advantage, but it's not the kind of advantage that accounts for the entirety of how the system is structured. It's an advantage. Well, you can say, well, that's not fair. It's like, yeah, okay, fair enough. Most systems are certainly not 100% either fair or just. Definitely not. But, you know, instead of comparing them to utopia, you might compare them to another system, which is the only reasonable way to do it. It's like everything looks terrible when you compare it to the best thing you can possibly imagine. But the best thing you can possibly imagine is it's an empty fiction because it's so devoid of detailed content that you can't use it as a guide to reality. Now, I mean, the idea that things could be better has its roots in some sense in a broad-scale utopian project, and I believe that things could be better, but that doesn't mean that when you're doing an analysis of a complex system, you get to compare it to an ideological utopia and then describe all the reasons that it's bad. It's not appropriate to do that. It's too simplistic. You're not going to do anything to actually address the problems that the system has if you take that approach. And then, of course, like pure utopian thinking is extraordinarily dangerous, because if you think that your way of molding society into some ultimate state of perfection is headed towards some ultimate state of perfection, then you can justify absolutely anything you do right now on the basis of the fact that things are going to improve so radically in the future. And that means any of your behaviors are excused. The end is worth it. Well, if someone says that, you have to kind of wonder what they're actually planning. Excuse me. What they're actually planning to do. Okay, what's the issue? Well, the issue is that it's... So the same critic with regards to Foucault, he said, you know, it's basically the same thing, that Foucault criticized a variety of profound institutions, sexual institutions, say, like marriage, and then institutions of power like prisons and institutions of mental health, you know, the whole institutional framework. He criticized them on the basis of power and exclusion, and you could do that, and there's some truth in it. But, you know, Foucault also made the presupposition. The problem with that presupposition is that everything is about something else, is that it's almost impossible to see how it can't be applied to Foucault himself. So you'd have to ask, if you were a student of Foucault, what power aims drove his attempt to analyze everything in terms of power. And I actually think with Foucault it's pretty obvious. So, but it's a game that never goes anywhere. Okay, so I thought about that a lot. It's like, is there any system that you can develop that doesn't have the negative consequences of systems in general? And then if that is possible, how and why might it be possible? And this is partly why I'm talking to you about this particular diagram again. And I think the reason, now I don't know this, and you guys can think it through yourself. I mean, lots of people have talked to me about the content of this course, and, you know, they've said that it's been very helpful for them when it comes to interpreting certain elements of their life, you know. But some people have said, well, it's just another system. And I don't believe that. I think it's a meta system. And I don't think the rules that apply to systems also apply to metasystems. But, you know, that could just be me. So you're going to have to decide that for yourself. But I think the reason that I can make that claim, and that it's a valid claim, is because, first of all, I don't believe it's an intellectual system. I don't think it's an attempt to reduce a complex set of phenomena to something that is... dispenses with important elements of their existence. Like, so for example, let me give you an example of how that sort of thing happens. Like, if you're looking at the world through a biased lens, what it means is you take non-random samples of the environmental data. So I can give you a quick example of something I saw that I thought was very particular in that regard. I don't think I've used this example before, but about 10 years ago or thereabouts, Naomi Klein made a documentary about this factory down in South America. I believe it was in Argentina. And this was just after all the foreign capital fled out of Argentina and the economy collapsed completely, which is something that happens to Argentina fairly regularly, by the way. And she went down there to this factory where there were working men, and they had been building heavy machinery, and the working men decided that they were going to, this factory had been padlocked, and they had been locked out because things had come to a halt. And they decided that they were going to take the chains off the factory gate and go in there and start making heavy machinery again. And, you know, it was a very cool documentary as far as I was concerned. She went down there and she interviewed all these working guys, and, you know, they talked about how their lives had been brought to a halt by the factory closure. And obviously it sucked that they were sitting around doing nothing and not being paid for anything when they could have been inside the factory building heavy machinery, which is what they wanted to do. So she went down there and laid out their story, and it was very sympathetic to the workers, and good, you know, fair enough, good. But then she went and interviewed the guy who owned the factory, and she didn't ask him any real questions, you know, because what she did instead was caricaturize him even a priori as sort of, you know, a fascist capitalist, sort of like the millionaire in Monopoly, and never tried to get beneath the superficial a priori categorization to find out what the hell he actually thought. And I was just waiting. I thought, okay, well, this is cool. What the hell does the factory owner have to say? It's like, where does money go? Why does he think he has a right to the factory? Like, what are his conditions of ownership? Did he earn the money? What, did he inherit it? It's like, what does he think about the fact that Argentina's economy has collapsed? What is he? How does he feel about the fact that all these workers are out of work? What does he think about the fact that they opened up the factory again? It, like, there's a lot of interesting things to ask this guy. None of it. None of it happened. And so, to me, what happened was that she was like someone with neglect. You know, she was looking at the world, but she could only see half of everything. And the half she saw was probably perfectly, you know, justifiable, had its proper domain of application. But the half she missed, it's like, well, what about that part of the story? You're going to reduce that to cliche and stereotype and expand up the rest of the story? Well, the only reason you do that is if you didn't want to find out what the hell was going on, if you all you wanted to do was gather evidence that would support your initial theory. Now, I know perfectly well that there's plenty of situations where workers, the conditions of workers are absolutely abysmal. I mean, one of the books I've read that's, I think, a remarkable documentation of that fact is a book by George Orwell called Road to Wigan Pier, which is a study of the conditions that coal miners lived in 1930s in Britain. And, you know, it's bloody dismal. And the idea that they were exploited, it's, well, that's a tougher one, because the Industrial Revolution was very, very hard on people. And it was really, really hard on some people, you know, particularly on some people. Whether that was because of exploitation or because of the existence of absolute poverty is not all that obvious. And, you know, so it's a complicated issue. Now, there's lots of times when workers were clearly exploited, but I think there were times as well when they weren't. Anyways, it's a great book, and, you know, he does a lovely job of laying out a rationale for why the workers should be treated far better than they were treated. And, it's, you know, so fine, good, wonderful. There's something to be said. But the thing is, when you want to say something, you want to take an unbiased sample if you can. And so this is why I like this particular mode of conceptualization. And I think it's, the reason I think it's not an intellectual construction is because I think it emerges naturally out of the structure of mythology and narrative. And you can think this through yourself. But as far as I've been able to tell, narratives present themselves in terms of archetypal characters. And the thing about a comprehensive narrative is it can't leave out an archetypal character, or it fails. Now, I can give you an example of this, okay? So, how many of you have seen Disney's Sleeping Beauty? Okay, so many of you have. How many haven't? Okay, so there's a few that haven't. Well, the Disney movies, you know, they're kind of standard childhood fare. Now, in Sleeping Beauty, what happens is that the king and queen give birth to a princess after trying for a substantial amount of time. And, you know, she arrives healthy and beautiful, and then they have a christening day, and they invite everybody to it, but they don't invite Maleficent, who's dark witch, roughly speaking. You know, like she's queen of the underworld, that for lack of a better word. She's the negative element of femininity. And they don't invite her to the party. And so she shows up anyways and says that because they didn't invite her, their daughter's going to die when she hits 16, which is, you know, roughly the age of, let's say, sexual maturation for a story of that sort. Now, there's another little positive magic female in the story who mitigates that death sentence to protracted sleep. Well, the idea behind it, it's a very, very interesting story. It's an Oedipal story in a sense, because what it says is that if your parents protect you too much from the dark side of life when you're young, that what will happen when you start to on the road to maturity is you'll be so naive and so fragile that you'll want to be unconscious instead of paying attention, and that you're going to have to be rescued from that state by something. And it could be a prince, which is how that story lays itself out, or it also could be the symbolically masculine and exploratory element of your own psyche. And the stories are ambivalent about whether it's an external event or an internal event. It doesn't really matter. You know, the things end up being the same. And so that's actually what happens in the Sleeping Beauty story. You know, at the end, a prince who's also enslaved by this terrible negative feminine force manages to escape, and the Maleficent turns into a dragon, and he has to fight her, and then he goes and rescues the princess, and she wakes up, and the kingdom's rejuvenated, and everybody's happy. It's a classic, classic story. You know, and it's not... It's funny because the Disney movie Frozen was put forward as a, in some sense, as a feminist alternative to the classic fairy tales. And first of all, you can't do that. You can't just generate up a fairy tale. You know, there's recent evidence that some of these fairy tales, the ones that the Grimm brothers and Hans Christian Andersen collected, are up to 10,000 years old. You can't just come up with a counter fairy tale. That's just not how it works. And the way that fairy tale is structured, it has nothing to do with the necessity for anyone to rely on anyone else for anything. It's a complex portrayal of the dynamic relationship between archetypal characters. And, you know, it's one form of the story. There's lots of different forms of the story. But what I like about Sleeping Beauty, for example, and this is what's nice about the real fairy tales, is that along with the positive, there's negative, and it's real negative. Like, real fairy tales are terrifying. Like, who is it? Is it in Sleeping Beauty or in Snow White? I don't remember. In one of the famous Grimm fairy tales, one of the evil sisters ends up dancing in red hot shoes till she dies. You know, they're very, very violent and unsettling, and it's because they have the quality of genuine folk tales. But the reason for that is because they're dealing with real things. Like the Hansel and Gretel story is a good example of that, right? Kids are abandoned out in the woods. They find something that's too good to be true. Inside this thing that's too good to be true is something that wants to fatten them up and devour them. It's a rough story. But what it's doing, the stories have evolved to represent the fundamental dynamic elements of existence. If you conceptualize existence in terms of character. And the thing is, you have to conceptualize existence in terms of character if you're a person, because what you do in existence is act out your character. So your character is an element of existence. Now, you might say, well, that doesn't mean that society has a character. But actually, it does mean that. And because partly what happens, like if you're socialized, say, into a culture, the culture exists in the same relationship to you, roughly speaking, as another person does. So, for example, if you put money in the bank, which is in principle a representation of your labor, what you're doing is entering into a contract with the broader social world, which is one of promise, essentially, where the future society promises to return your value at a future date. So it's a contractual relationship. And the reason that God the Father is a very common representation is because treating the they in Heideggerian terms, the others in Heideggerian terms, as if they're an embodied entity actually works. So It's because it is an emergent property of all of the personalities that make it up. And so you're interacting with that emergent personality all the time. You could even say, for example, that that's the Freudian id. It's the thing that the representation of that inside you is what makes you feel guilty when you transgress against certain moral rules. And you might say, along with the radical existentialists, that that's just arbitrary and that you can create your own values. But it's not just arbitrary, because it's dependent on the consent of others as well as on some internal harmony or disharmony. It's not arbitrary. And you can't just set that up by yourself. So, you know, these things are realities, and they're deep realities. Now, this particular portrayal indicates a kind of balance. So the fundamental ground of reality is neither positive nor negative. It's the ground out of which everything positive or negative emerges. So you might think of the fundamental ground of reality as that which exists prior to your encounter with it. And we have no idea what that is. Now, you can think about it as people tend to think about what things are made of in atomic terms, but it's not a particularly comprehensive way of thinking about it, because what exists beyond the realm of your comprehension is the patterned relationship between everything and everything. And you can't reduce it to any simple level of analysis, because you miss all sorts of elements of it that are extraordinarily important if you do that. So you can't do that. That's not what experience is made out of, you know, or what the ground of experience is made out of. And so it's neutral in some sense, because it exists beyond your encounter with it. It's the unknown as such. And the reason that that's often represented in the form of a predatory lizard that has something to offer is precisely because of that. It's like the absolute unknown has the capacity to tear you into pieces and burn you up, but it also has the possibility of rewarding you with everything you could possibly be rewarded with. So it's this strange juxtaposition of potential. I like to think about it as potential, you know, because people can get a grip on what potential means. There's potential everywhere, whatever that is. You have potential. Your parents tell you that all the time. What is that? Well, it's the unrealized stuff of your being. Now, it's a very strange concept, potential, because you can't characterize it any way that you would characterize something that's real, because it's not real. It's potential. But you act like it's real. You know, you'll feel guilty that you're not living up to your potential. You're not manifesting your potential. You want people to interact with you so that they allow you to demonstrate your potential. Like, you act as if it's a reality continually. You think as if it's a reality continually. You ask if your relationship has potential, you know. But it's a very, very strange substance, whatever this potential is. It's unrealized possibility, essentially. But you regard it as something that's fluid and something that can develop in all sorts of different directions, and something whose development you can shape, because otherwise why would you feel guilty? It's like, you know, if you're doing the wrong thing, you're realizing some potential in the wrong way, and then you feel bad about that. It's like, well, there's some sense of intrinsic morality operating at the bottom of that. We've talked a lot about that. Some of that's built in biologically, some of it's, you know, structured culturally. Some of it's a consequence of you trying to organize this plethora of semi-beings that you are into some integrated manner. Like, it's a very, very complicated thing. And it's not just arbitrary. Okay, so that's the very background, the dragon of chaos, positive and negative, and it's the thing out of which everything springs. If you look at the Scandinavian world tree, for example, or world trees in general, you very frequently have a representation of a serpent that's associated with them. And the reason that that potential is regarded as serpentine is extraordinarily complicated, but I think it's partly because snakes shed their own skin, and so they can be reborn, so they're a symbol of transformation. And then they're sneaky and subtle, and so they appear in places you wouldn't necessarily expect them to, and then they're a terrible, terrible threat, but in overcoming that threat, you also develop. So not only are they a threat, but they're the kind of threat that makes you become strong while you face it. So that's partly why the snake is such an ambivalent figure in most mythology. So, okay, so that's complicated, but we'll return to that later. And then out of that, you might say, emerges the unknown as you encounter it. So there's potential itself, and then the first layer of potential are the things that you encounter that you don't understand. So I can give you an example of that. So let's say you're a 3-year-old or 2-year-old, that's better, and you're in your kitchen and a mouse runs across the room. And so you track it because, you know, your eyes pick up the movement, then you track the thing, and then it's an unexpected occurrence, so you don't know what it signifies, right? So that's the emergence of something tangibly unknown into your conceptual space. Now, it's like not like you lack any knowledge of it. You can tell that what its size is, and you can get some estimation of its speed. You know, and I think that what you have to do when you think about whether or not something is unknown is you have to think about it in relationship to that hierarchy of perception that I keep throwing at you. You know, if something emerges, if you encounter an entity and you can map it at every single level of your value hierarchy, then it's known. You know how to interact with it at a micro level, and you know what its implications are for every other level of your conceptual being. You know what its implications are for the future. Like, you know exactly how to deal with that thing. It's mapped at every single level. There's other things that are only mapped at one level and not at others. So maybe, you know, you like the mouse, we'll say, for the child who's never seen a mouse, it's like it shares some commonalities with objects that the child is familiar with. But there's sufficient novelty so that it's also contaminated with the unknown. And that makes the child basically alert, semi-startled and alert. Now, the child will immediately refer to an adult. It's a technical term, actually. They'll look at the adult's face because the adult's face will broadcast the motivational and affective significance of that event. And so the child looks, references, and then reads off the face, and of course the speech and the bodily actions, exactly what that thing signifies, you know. And then if the person that they're looking at jumps up on the table and screams, then that's one set of meanings, which is, God, this thing is magical, it's only this big, and look at what effect it has on, you know, my aunt, for the sake of argument, who's, you know, a pretty competent creature, as far as I can tell, being 2 years old, you know. And then if she just dismisses it, you know, her actions are going to determine the meaning of that phenomena. So that's how the transformation of the semi-known thing into the more known thing occurs. It occurs almost always in a social context. You can explore things by yourself, but you rarely actually do that by yourself. It's almost always you plugged into a social apparatus, you know. So you might be doing the specific investigating, but the social apparatus is around you so that you can confer with it, and it also shapes the way that you're going to interact with that specific thing. Okay, so the unknown, that's generally, that the unknown that you encounter, that's generally characterized using feminine symbolism. And I think the reason for that, there's a bunch of reasons, and we've talked about many of them. One reason is because females do the sexual selection in human beings, and so they act as the face of nature. Another reason is that you can think of new possibility always emerging out of the non-cultural background in some sense, you know. So, for example, let's say that we send an expedition to Mars, and we're gathering new information as a consequence. The reason we're gathering new information is because we've gone out past the domain of our knowledge, in a sense, and we're interacting with something new. And in that interaction, new information is generated. Now, you can say that it's partly the act of the perceiver that's generating the new information. And you can say that it's partly the act of the culture, because we send robots to Mars, let's say, which is very, very difficult. So the culture goes there, but the individuals are observing. So the individuals are buttressed by the culture, but they're generating information because they're somewhere truly new. And so the information You know, the unknown is a constant source of new information. So it's the place that gives birth to new information. And so that's another part of the reason that it seems to be symbolized in feminine form. You know, I'm just taking this in some sense as an empirical fact. I've looked at, it looks like that's how these stories work. And so I'd be trying to puzzle out why exactly that would be the case. You know, I also think it's the case that we tend to look at the world from a social cognitive perspective, right? We filter it through a social cognitive biological apparatus. And so we're very likely to see things in character form, and characters have sexes. And so that's going to happen. And then which the attributes of femininity or the attributes of masculinity that get used as symbolic reference, in some sense, there's an arbitrariness about it. So for example, for the Egyptians, you know, usually you have a sky god, but they had a sky goddess. Now, she generally represent the night sky, which is not exactly the same thing as the day sky. But, you know, you have to, it's so tricky because you have to look at the relationships between the characters in order to decide what all of them mean. And that shifts a little bit from story to story. So this is a, what would you say? It's an approximation of the underlying structure, but there's a fair bit of variance in it, just like there's variation in stories. So, well, the feminine element has a destructive element and a creative aspect. And you can see that people characterize their environments in that way. So, for example, you can map on environmental beliefs onto this structure. You can say that the environmentalist portrays nature as positive, portrays culture as negative, and portrays the individual as negative. And the basic story is rampaging individual as member of rapacious culture invading the pristine landscape of beautiful Mother Nature. Now, the thing about that story is it's true. The problem with the story is it's half true. Now, so for example, one thing that's interesting to conceptualize is that that's exactly the opposite of the frontier myth. Now, the frontier myth was a story that was used extensively in Europe to drive immigration into the United States. And it was used to some degree in Canada too. And the story was the exact opposite. It's the hero, so that would be the immigrant, pioneer, bringing the benefits of order to a savage wilderness. Well, that's also true. But it's so interesting that both of those things can be true, and they're completely different from one another. There's no commonality at all between those two stories, except for the way that they use the characters. There's a feminine character, a masculine character that represents culture, and then there's another character that represents the individual. And you could even see that, if you think about it historically, the U.S. was founded in some sense on a frontier myth. And, you know, that was too one-sided, and so by the time the 1960s came along, the early 1960s, it shifted to its opposite. And that you need that because systems have to oscillate to some degree to remain stable across time. They can't just be fixed in place. So they're going to play back and forth through the archetypes in an attempt to keep them balanced, because that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to keep them balanced. And so, well, you have the destructive and creative element of Mother Nature. You see that all the time in movies where the thing that the hero is striving against is the negative element of the unknown. How many of you have seen the movie Alien? Okay, so, you know, that's a pretty graphic representation of, well, those aliens are more reptilian in form. So they're almost like, They're more at the dragon of chaos level of symbolization. But they're like a terrible external force that's threatening human culture and the individual. It's exactly the opposite story that's played out in, what was the movie with all the blue creatures?
Avatar.
Mm-hmm. Avatar, right. Avatar is exactly the opposite of that, where, you know, the unknown nature is just nothing but, it's like sweetness and bliss, and, you know, And the human culture is portrayed as spearheaded by greedy and rapacious individuals who are basically manifestations of the military-industrial complex. The funny thing is those both make good stories. And that's because, well, it's because they have enough archetypal truth so that there's many situations that they're relevant to. You know, sometimes Mother Nature is your best friend, and sometimes it's your worst enemy. And so you could go down to the jungles of Peru, and you could talk to the the people who live there, and you could find out what they know about medicinal plants in the jungle, and you could bring home things to cure disease. Or you could just go down there and get lost in the jungle, and then you're dead. You know, in some sense, it's the same jungle. And whether it's positive or negative depends on what stance you take towards it and how you behave. And so the other thing that's really interesting about mythology, and this is the lovely element of mythology, is that part of what it does is tell you how to take this incredibly complex landscape that's positive and negative at the same time at every level of analysis, and how to navigate through it so that the proper balance is maintained as far as, really, as far as the entire system is concerned. So that culture has an orderly element, and that's what protects us here, and it has a tyrannical element, and that's what makes you treated like numbers at the University of Toronto. You know, you get both of those at exactly the same time. And then the archetypal individual has the same fundamental nature, hero or villain. And, you know, those have archetypal roots, because the ultimate hero is the ultimate perfect person, and the ultimate villain is, you know, Satan himself in whatever form he happens to take. You know, and it doesn't take much knowledge of this structure before you can start seeing it manifest itself all over, especially in movies that are particularly popular, because they almost always have a central archetypal theme. The Marvel superhero movies are a really good example of that. So, you know, and if it's complex literature, the archetypes are mixed to some degree. So you have a hero who's not only a hero, you have a hero who has all sorts of flaws, you know, and he's in a culture, or she's in a culture that has positive elements and negative elements, and they're in a broader landscape that's characterized by exactly the same thing. So it's nuanced, you know, and the more sophisticated you get, the more you can tolerate that kind of nuance. And I think that's also one of the things, that's partly why literature is such a good antidote to ideology, because the more sophisticated the literature becomes, the more complex and fragmented in some sense, or no, differentiated, the more differentiated the archetypal landscape becomes. So when someone tells you a story, whatever the story happens to be, one of the things you can do when you know this substructure is you can say, okay, yeah, but where are the missing pieces? Where are they going? Because if they're not included, then they're generally projected onto something. You know, because they're there, you can't get away from them. They're there. How does the person account for them? You know, so. All right, so then now I want to tell you another story. So we talked about the Mesopotamian creation myth last week, and now I want to tell you about the Egyptian myth of sovereignty. And so the first thing I should do is say that all of the stories that I'm talking to you about have all sorts of variants, you know. And so the Egyptian story that I'm going to describe lasted for thousands and thousands of years. And so it isn't like there was only one variation of it. There's all sorts of variations of it, and I'm only going to tell you one of them. And that's a limitation, but that's just how it is for the time being. So I'm not saying that this is the only version of this story. But it's a version, and it's the one I'm most familiar with, and so I can talk about it, hopefully with some utility. And it's a great story. When I finally figured out what it meant, it's so cool with some of these stories. Like, if you crack them and you're able to see what they mean, they're absolutely overwhelming. They're so bloody brilliant. It's just, it's no wonder that people regard them as revelatory, you know, of divine origin, because they have such power that it's almost impossible to imagine how that could have got there. Now, I have provided you with a Darwinian explanation of how that got there, right? Because the stories are representations of social contracts and behavioral tendencies that have evolved over thousands and thousands of years. Because of that, the representation, the story is going to have way more information in it than a typical story might. But I still can understand how these things burst upon people with the force of revelation. You know, and one of the things that's quite interesting, too, if you look at cultures historically, is that you usually find that the revelation of the story It's like the energy source on which the culture feeds. So the story comes first. It has this tremendous dynamic energy. The culture basically uses that energy to propel itself through time, you know, to give it conviction and force. And then at some point, the story exhausts itself. And that would be equivalent, in some sense, I suppose, to Nietzsche's announcement of the death of God. And this has happened many times. So, all right, so there's four main characters in the Egyptian story. There's Osiris, Isis, Set, and Horus. Now, Osiris, we'll start with Osiris, but you could start with any of the characters, because one of the things that's quite interesting about mythology is that the myths don't make any distinction between the causal priority of these characters. Any of them can be regarded as fundamental. So the hero is the person who separates the world parents, for example, and brings being into existence. But you can also say, well, it's Tiamat, which is more how the Mesopotamian creation myth is tilted. Or you can say, well, you can't make sense out of anything unless you have a cultural lens through which you're looking. Like, you know, there has to be some pre-existent structure before information can be generated in any manner. So you're always stuck with this problem that in order for something to exist, you need a substrate, you need an interpretive structure, and you need an interpreter. And that's, and you can't say that one of those things precedes the other. They all have to be there at the same time. You could say from a Darwinian perspective, they all emerged and complexified in unison, like that, as you know, as time progressed. It doesn't explain how they originated, however. Okay, so you've got Osiris. Now, Osiris is the founder of the Egyptian state. And so, you know, before people wrote things down, you have to kind of try to understand how it was that they remembered things. Like, their memory was more like an amalgam or a gist. So we already know that, you know, if you tell the story of your actions yesterday, that it doesn't take you 16 hours to tell the story. Hopefully, it takes you like 5 minutes. And why that is not obvious, but part of the reason is that for whatever underlying reasons, you know what parts of the story are relevant to other people and what parts aren't. So basically what you're going to do is try not to tell them things they already know, because that'd just be pointless. And in order to do that, you more or less have to know what they know and what they don't know, and you have to more or less stay on the edge of that. But you can do that. Well, I might ask you, well, what did you do over the last 3 months? Or I could say, well, what have you done for the last couple of years? And in each case, you're going to collapse that into some representation. Now imagine that the problem you're trying to solve is, what did your culture do for the last 5,000 years? Well, imagine that there are the culture in part is being continually informed by the individuals that compose it. And there are going to be different individuals of different stature who discover things of different importance, you know, and we often know some people like that. We know of Thomas Edison, for example, and we can name actual people, but that's part because we write things down and have records of them. You can imagine, though, that you're trying to represent your history in a way that you can remember. You're going to tell stories about people who've done interesting things, because that's what you do even when you tell a story about yourself. So imagine you tell one story about someone who did something interesting, and then you tell another story about someone else who did something interesting, and so forth, and that's continually going on, let's say, in a tribal or archaic culture. And so then what you get is a set of stories about people doing interesting things. Well, it's easy for that to shift into the ancestors doing interesting things, and then it's easy for that to shift into the ancestor doing wonderful things. And that's basically what happens, is that you get the emergence of the culture story, which is something like a small set of culture heroes who've done all the things that are worth doing, and what you're doing is imitating them. And you know, this is, you know, your empirical memory of events only lasts about 100 years, right? Because there isn't anyone old enough to remember anything past that. And so what has to happen is that everything that happened before that has to be collapsed into some form that's memorable so that it can be brought forward and taught. And that's the function of these stories. These stories actually, it's almost as if the story has abandoned everything that hasn't stuck in people's memories. And so all that's left is the most significant. Because otherwise, why would people bother with it? They wouldn't tell the story and they wouldn't be gripped by it. So Osiris, he's one of these figures. You could think, if you allowed people to tell stories about George Washington, say, and Abe Lincoln, and all the semi-mythologized founders of the United States, if you allowed people, in the absence of textbooks and writing, to tell stories about those men for the next 1,000 years, maybe what you'd get out of that is an origin story of the mythic founder of the state. And that seems to be what's happened in the Egyptian case with Osiris. Now, he's a god, but he's got human characteristics. And so he's also granted the status of something that's eternal. Okay, now, here's the story of Osiris, roughly speaking. He's kind of old now, and he's a little bit blind, but he's blind in a specific way, and the way that he's specifically blind is that he's willfully blind. Now, if you're willfully blind about, the Egyptians say this straightforwardly, and I'll tell you why they believe this. If you're willfully blind, there's things that you could know that you take pains not to know. And willful blindness under English common law can be grounds for criminal conviction. So, for example, if you run a company and you think that your treasurer is cooking the books, but it's working to your favor, and you decide, well, I just won't look, and then later it comes out, you can say, well, I didn't know, and people who are prosecuting can say, yeah, but you could have known, and you took a conscious choice not to know, so you're culpable. And I think that's actually the best model of Freudian repression, in a sense, is that it isn't exactly repression. It's failure to make the effort to know something that you could know. So, now sometimes, sometimes something terrible happens to you and you just can't understand it. But sometimes something terrible is happening and you refuse to think about it. And because you refuse to think about it, you really don't know what it is. And you might say, well, I can't be culpable then because I don't know what it is. But you could have known. So you're culpable. So it's voluntary ignorance. And that's the problem with Osiris. He was a great guy when he was young. He was a hero. He founded the Egyptian state. But, you know, he's not everything he could be anymore. He's got anachronistic and outdated and willfully blind, which is even worse. Now, there's an idea here. It's such a bloody brilliant idea. It's mind-boggling. So Osiris is the state manifested in personified form. And that's reasonable, because the state is like a person. The person of the state is manifested in the body of laws. And you guys all imitate that body of laws, and that's what basically makes you citizens of the state. You okay? Okay, good. Good. So that's what makes you citizens of the state. You can all get along because all of you are imitating the same thing. And what you're imitating is the central body of custom and law that makes up the state. That's why you can predict each other. So that makes you a good citizen. Now, you know, the problem with being a good citizen is that sometimes if you're a good citizen, you're a bad person, right? That's a big problem. So, for example, the better you were at being a Nazi, in all likelihood, the worse a person you were. And so that's a very useful observation, because one of the things it shows is that even though it's necessary for you to imitate the central personality of the state, sometimes the central personality of the state can be pathological. And the Egyptians, who'd established quite a lengthy state, you know, as opposed, say, to the Mesopotamians, the Egyptians had been existing in a complex state apparatus for a very long period of time, they started to encounter problems that were intrinsic to the state. Now, you remember, in the Mesopotamian creation myth, the primary danger was Tiamat, you know, You make a lot of racket. You kill Apsu, that's order. Tiamat comes flooding back and takes you out. Well, you can imagine that that would be the primary story of people in a civilization that was somewhat fragile. They're a hell of a lot more worried about being invaded by the next, you know, round of barbarians or having their crops fail or being flooded out or something like that than they are concerned about whether or not the whole state apparatus has become corrupt and is going to collapse. Now, they're partly concerned about that because, remember, Marduk is supposed to be, the emperor is supposed to be being a good Marduk and keeping an eye on everything. But the mythic structure only talks about Apsu a tiny little bit. They basically say, don't kill Tiamat's consort or you'll make her angry. Okay, the Egyptians take that a lot farther. They look at Osiris and they say, well, there was really something good about him. Without him, we wouldn't even have our state. So we bloody well better be happy about that because the state is better than no state. You know, you could say pathological order is better than absolute chaos. Now, you can have an argument about that, but whatever. It's, you know, depends on how pathological the order, obviously. But it isn't that untrammeled chaos is a good solution. You know, I think that you can, and I'm only using this as an example. You know, the Americans, well, and us as well, went into Iraq to take out a person who was clearly a dictator, you know, and who was a pretty bad guy and who had really bad sons. You know, and his heroes were people like Stalin and Hitler. Well, they took him out. Well, then what? Well, then all hell broke loose. You know, because the theory was you take out the bad guy at the top and all the good guys at the bottom get together and instantly they have a good government. It's like that isn't what happened at all. What happened was the whole state degenerated into chaos. And partly out of that chaos came ISIS. And it's not self-evident that ISIS is preferable to Hussein. At least Hussein educated all the women. You know, and he was relatively secular, all things considered. So I'm not making a case for Hussein. My point is that, you know, you have to be careful when you disrupt order, even if it's pathological, because God only knows what's going to spring forth. And that doesn't mean that you should never try to overcome pathological order, but it does mean that you should be very, very careful when you do so. You know, you have to do a microanalysis in some sense to make sure that you know what the hell you're doing. So, all right, so anyway, so Osiris, he's a good guy, man. He established the state. He was a wake guy. He was a hero. He, you know, made order out of chaos, and that's where you live. So great, but he's a little old, a little out of date, and he's willfully blind. And that's so smart, because I think what the Egyptians did is encapsulate in narrative form the primary danger of all human institutions. There's two of them. And Eliade talks about this a lot with regards to flood mythology. So here's an example. So there are flood myths all over the world. And there may have even been a flood. There's pretty good archaeological evidence for that, that there was a great flood about 13,000 years ago when a bunch of comets hit the Earth and melted the North American ice shield. But we won't get into that. But it doesn't really matter because the mythological substructure of the story still has the same meaning regardless of its historical reality. So in the biblical story of the flood, basically what happens is that humanity is created, then they degenerate rapidly. And they get so degenerate, which is sort of like the elder gods getting out of hand in the Mesopotamian story, that God thinks, oh, to hell with all of you, you're a big mistake. I'm just going to wipe you out. You know, but he finds one good guy, that's Noah, and, you know, out of Noah, who's like another Adam in some sense, the world is of human beings is regenerated. But the idea is that corrupt people get washed away. So, and Iliada talks about the flood myth all over the world, Mircea Eliade. And he says that generally speaking, there's two reasons why the deities flood the planet. And one is the system is old and out of date. And the second is that people are corrupt. And then if you get the two things working together, you get a system that's out of date that becomes pathological faster because people are corrupt. And so I think that you can use the flood in New Orleans as a good example of that. Because on the one hand, you can say, well, it was a hurricane, so that's a natural disaster. But on the other hand, you could say, well, people knew the damn dikes were too weak, and they didn't do anything about it. You know, they were only built for a 100-year storm, and Louisiana is corrupt beyond belief. I mean, for a democratic state, it's not corrupt compared to most states, but it's really corrupt compared to most democratic states. And if you dump money into Louisiana, it just goes into people's pockets anyways, and the infrastructure doesn't get fixed up. So then you might ask yourself, well, was the flood a consequence of a natural disaster or the blindness of the culture? Well, you can never tell which of those are true, you know. If you freeze to death in the winter, is it because it's cold or because you're stupid? You know, it's there's no difference between those two things. So if you get wiped out, it's because nature comes after you and because your culture isn't sufficient to protect you. And so you can't separate those two things. Okay, so now, the other case that the Egyptians are making, and this is quite cool, is that if you take a system that's doing just fine, and you just leave it alone long enough, it becomes dysfunctional. And there's a bunch of reasons for that. I mean, you know, you can imagine that you take your laptop, and it's in perfect working order, and you put it in the closet for 20 years, and you take it out. What do you have? Well, it'll still turn on. Do you have a laptop? Well, no. You know, by then, it won't even work. It won't be able to communicate with the internet. There won't be any peripherals that can plug into it. The software will be so outdated that you won't even know how to use it. Like, it's a brick, basically. And so the point is that, and you can really see this with electronic equipment, a perfectly functional thing maintained in stasis of its own accord becomes dysfunctional. And so what that means is you have to run around like a mad hyena just keeping your things working. Now, of course, you know that because, like, how much time do you spend in a month updating your electronics? You know, it's just a treadmill of update, you know. And I think part of the reason that they haven't contributed much to overall productivity is because people take all the time they used to waste typing things out on paper trying to keep their efficient electronics actually working. And, you know, learning all the things you have to learn and relearning them. There's this scene in Alice in Wonderland. So Alice is in the underworld, right? And she meets the Red Queen down there. So that's Mother Nature. And she's always running around going off with her heads, which is in an arbitrary way, which is, of course, what the Red Queen does. And at one point she tells Alice, it's such a remarkably deep line. She says to Alice, "In my kingdom, you have to run as fast as you can just to stay in the same place." And that's exactly right. So you can think the environment that you're trying to adapt to is a dynamic concatenation of patterns, and it's transforming across time, not completely unpredictably, but certainly not predictably. And so that means that if you build a structure that is adapted to it, that structure has to change and flow in keeping with the change and flow of the underlying environment, or it gets outdated. You know, it gets, what do you call that, obsolescent. And so all you have to do is sit there and do nothing, and you'll become obsolescent. And so that's part of the problem with Osiris being old. He was a good guy when he was young, but he's old now, and the old solutions don't solve the new problems. And you could call that an Egyptian existential statement. All of you have a culture. It's old. It doesn't apply. Or it doesn't apply well. And so what are you going to do with it? You going to throw the whole thing out? Well, we know what happens. The Mesopotamians already told us what happens if you do that. It's like Tiamat comes flooding back and all hell breaks loose. So you can't throw everything away, but it doesn't work very well. So it's up to you to figure out how to fix it. So, okay, so now Osiris has got another problem. So you might say, well, let's say you've got an old computer. This, by the way, in case you haven't noticed, is a very old computer. And, you know, if you keep tapping on it and upgrading it a little bit, you can keep it more or less up to date. At some point, you're going to have to throw the whole damn thing away. But you can do incremental changes to it on a continual basis, and the thing will more or less stay functional. You can think about those incremental changes as partial revolutions, right? Matt, remember that hierarchy. Now and then you have to change the operating system. That sucks, because that means everything underneath virtually has to change. But more often you're doing a tweak here and a tweak there, you know, at lower, more specific levels, and if you tweak enough, then the probability that the whole thing is going to collapse and that you'll have to do a clean install is quite low. Well, the same thing applies to the state. Logically enough, this is the state, right? If you think your laptop isn't the state, then you're not thinking about your laptop properly. It's the state. So, and it's going to be more and more the state as we progress over the next 20 years, you know. So you know that if you're aware and you keep the updates up and you stay awake, that you can keep the thing functioning. At some point, it's going to get so anachronistic, it's better just to replace it, which is also, by the way, what's going to happen to all of you, right? And it's a decision that evolution, in some sense, in biology has made, that at some point, trying to keep you updated is so bloody complicated that you might as well just get rid of the whole thing and let something new occur. And I'm really dead serious about this, because death evolved. You know, you have elements in you that are 3.5 billion years old. Not everything dies. And some creatures are functionally immortal. So, but not us. And the reason is well, at some point we're too old to be updated, and so that's the end of that. Seems to happen over about a 100-year period. So, anyways, you can do increment. Now, imagine you just ignore your computer completely. You don't update the thing at all. Well, it's going to get anachronistic of its own accord. But if you refuse to engage in those operations that would keep it updated, it's going to get anachronistic a lot faster. And that's what happens to Osiris. They say the same thing. It's like, he's old, and that's part of the problem. He's past his prime, but the worst part of the problem is that he's willfully blind. He won't take action, even though he knows it's necessary. And so he gets out of date and pathological faster than necessary. Now, you know, when you hear in the flood stories that God is angry about the sins of men, and that's why he washes everything away, it's the same idea. Now, the word sin comes from the Greek word hamartia, and hamartia is an archery term. And to sin means not to hit the center of the target. And so basically, the idea in the flood stories is that if enough people aren't aiming at the target or hitting the center, then things are going to get so corrupt and unstable that everything is going to get washed away. And that's right. It's exactly perfectly accurate. So, which is very, very cool. It's remarkable that that's the case. Okay, so now Osiris, because this is a myth, has an evil brother. Now, that's pretty common occurrence. If you look at the Lion King, which is very much the Egyptian creation myth, by the way, the Lion King, what's the old guy's name? The old lion. Do you remember?
Mufasa.
He has a brother, right? What's his brother?
Scar.
And what's the problem with Scar? He's scarred. Right, so, you know, he's had... He says he's from the bottom of the gene pool. And, you know, he's been in second place all his life. But that's not... And he's very, very intelligent. He worships his own intelligence. He regards himself as a higher form of intellect, which is very common characteristic of evil brothers in mythology. And there's a reason for that. And he's scarred because life has scarred him. And he's bitter and resentful. And he wants to bring down order. And he wants to kill the son of the king. I mean, he's a bad guy. Now, the problem is that Mufasa underestimates him. And that's exactly what happens to Osiris. Osiris has this brother, Set. Or Seth. And I have a sneaking suspicion that our word Set for setting sun is from that word. Although I don't know that for sure. But sounds are generally... sounds in language remain stable across a very long period of time. And Set was definitely, from the Egyptian perspective, the enemy of the sun. So, you know, that's part of the Egyptian cosmology. And the sun is associated with illumination and brightness and daytime consciousness and clear apprehension and vision and all of those things. And of course, the night is opposed to that, unconsciousness and blindness and danger and all of those things. So anyway, Seth... he's pretending to be Osiris's loving brother, but he's not. He's plotting to overthrow him, first chance he gets. And so he's just sitting in the background, feeding him bad advice, waiting for him to get weak enough so that he can strike. Now the name Set is taken by the Egyptian Coptics and turned into Satan. So Set is the precursor of the Christian Satan. So you can, the reason I'm telling you that is so that you can see how these ideas, these archetypal ideas of corruption and evil, are extraordinarily ancient, and they're part of the process whereby people are trying to figure out what the right way is to act and what the wrong way is to act, and what the right way is to set up institutions and what the wrong way is to set up institutions. So it's a very, very long process, and it's not something that someone just sat around and thought up. It's way, way deeper than that. So anyways, Osiris is being, you know, getting weaker and being blind, and one day Seth thinks, all right, time for action. So he takes his brother and he chops him up into little pieces. Now, Osiris is a god, so you're not going to kill him, but you can make it very difficult for him to get his act together. Now, so basically what happens is Osiris falls apart. Now, think about that. You fall apart. People say that. The relationship fell apart. I fell apart. Things fall apart. What does that mean? Well, it means that a thing is usually a complex unity of multiple sub-entities, and sometimes what holds them together, the superordinate structure, collapses, and all that's left are the things. You know, because like when you fall apart, you don't completely fall apart. You know, you're still alive. What's happened is that the unity of your psychological structure has been fragmented, and that's a trip to the underworld, man. So you're going to be unhappy. I broke up with my partner, and then I fell apart. Well, everyone knows what that means. Okay, so that's what happens to Osiris. Things fall apart. So then Seth, being a sneaky sort of character, takes all of Osiris's pieces and he puts them all over Egypt. He hides them in here and there so that Osiris is going to have a hell of a time recollecting himself and getting his act together and coming back. And so things fall apart. Now the same thing happens in The Lion King, obviously, because Scar kills Mufasa. So fine. Then Seth rules. That's not a good day for the Egyptians. Remember what happens in The Lion King when Scar rules? The environment becomes completely devastated because they overhunt, right? So you get total environmental devastation. It's all black and burnt, and you know nothing is functioning properly. And remember, after Simba comes back to set things right, it starts to rain and everything comes back to life. Well, it's another indication of the idea that you really can't separate the environment from the culture. You know, they're in a dynamic system of interaction. Anyways, Osiris, things have fallen apart. Well, Osiris has a wife. He has to. He's king of order. Well, we're missing someone. We're missing the queen of chaos. We're missing the queen of the underworld. That's Isis. Now, Isis was a long-lasting goddess. There's been goddess religions forever. There's an idea among misinformed feminist anthropologists that the original religious structures were feminine, earth goddess-type religions, and then they were replaced by patriarchal religions. And there's no historical evidence for that. And the best work I know on that is actually through the Jungians. Jung and Eric Neumann, because what they figured out, they're kind of on the same track, thinking about the same idea, that there seemed to be a shift between matriarchal values to patriarchal values, and that was a historical shift. But what they found instead was that that's actually a mythological idea. It's not a historical reality. And it's useful as a mythological idea, but you shouldn't project it backwards onto time and make it a historical reality. So, anyways, Isis, she's been queen of the underworld forever. Now, of course, when order collapses, chaos reappears, and that's what happens. Isis pops up out of the underworld, and her husband's missing, and she's not very happy about that. So she wanders all over Egypt looking for his phallus. And so, now that's an interesting idea, because it touches on like the biology of innovation in some sense. So you've heard of the notion of a seminal idea. Well, that's a mythologically informed metaphor. And so the idea is that in biological reproduction, semen falls on fertile ground and out of that something emerges. Well, there's a tight analog between that and what happens in the Egyptian myth with regards to sexuality. Now, Jung and Freud had a big argument about this, eh? Because Freud thought you could reduce everything to sexuality. And Freud said that. And Jung said, no, what you don't understand is that sexuality itself is often used as a symbol for something even more profound. And they didn't agree on that, and that's part of why they went their separate ways. Freud was very much unwilling to believe that religion could be anything other than a set of defensive and repressive beliefs and practices designed to protect you from death anxiety. That was basically his hypothesis. And it's wrong. It's not, there is that element, of course, because you can use dogma to protect yourself against all sorts of things you don't want to think about. But you can't reduce the whole damn thing to that. You've got to watch people of any type that are intellectuals who will tell you that everything can be reduced to one cause. You know, it's like a misplaced monotheism. Lots of people do that. For Marx, it's economics or class warfare. For Freud, it's sexuality, although he also considers aggression. For Foucault, it's power. You know, it's like, no, it's not that simple. You can make a good story out of those motivations because they're powerful motivations and they do affect everything, but that doesn't mean they cause everything unidimensionally. Okay, so anyways, Isis pops up, queen of the underworld. Seth takes control. Chaos emerges from the underworld. Isis wanders around. She finds Osiris's phallus and she makes herself pregnant. Well, so what does that mean? Well, it means a lot of things. One thing it means is that if a great system falls apart, the parts still have life. And, you know, you can think about that. People often talk about the stability to the degree that it's stable. Part of the stability of capitalism is its creative destruction, is that capitalism allows great enterprises to collapse and disperse. But they don't break down into subatomic particles, right? They collapse, but the pieces they collapse into still have life, some of them more than others. And then if something collapses, sometimes part of the thing that collapsed has enough life to build something new out of the pieces. That's the same thing that happens to you when you undergo a radical, you know, a revolutionary transformation in your character. You know, you might even feel like you're dying. And in some sense, the organizing principles by which you lived are dying. That's what's taking you out. And it's painful. You know, those things are alive. It's no trivial matter to be taken apart. But, you know, you hope that you get taken apart, you can find some new information down there in the chaos, and that's your union with Isis, roughly speaking. And out of that union of information from the chaos and the parts of you that are left, you can come springing back. And, you know, everyone hopes that, and often it's the case. You know, one of the lessons you can derive from Egyptian mythology is bloody well stay awake and make the little corrections when you need to. Don't be willfully blind, because if you're willfully blind, you're gonna store up chaos because you're not, you know, keeping at bay. And then one day when you're weak, it's just gonna take you out. And that happens. That happens to people all the time. You know, they let things around them degenerate back into chaos. And then one day they're weak and something else comes along to hit them and they're done. They can't get up. It's too heavy. It's too hard to hit. And so then they're down in the underworld and they stay there. So, the general rule is if you're going to go to the underworld, it's better to go on purpose and for short voyages. And that's the idea behind voluntary exposure, right? Find out what you don't want to look at. It's easy enough to do that because you're going to see yourself avoiding it. Then figure out how you can approach it and order some of it, you know, in as big a chunks as you can manage. And do that all the time. Stay awake, because then you keep your infrastructure properly maintained, and the probability that you'll be able to tolerate a powerful blow is much, much higher. It's not certain. That's the other thing about myths. You know, they tell you the best way to negotiate through life, but they never tell you that that will work. They just tell you that that's your best bet. And so, you know, maybe that's enough. It might be enough. Okay, so anyways, Isis finds Osiris's phallus and gets pregnant. And then back to the underworld she goes. And she goes through her pregnancy and she gives birth to Horus. Now that's a pretty common story, right? That's the long lost rightful king. You know, in King Arthur, for example, Arthur has to be taken away from the castle to be raised basically in isolation. It's a very, very common story. And the reason, the same thing happens to Harry Potter, right? Harry Potter is stuck with these Dursleys, and, you know, they're like every resentful child's image of their parents, you know. So maybe it's more like every resentful 13-year-old's image of their parents. And, you know, the truth of the matter is you are kind of stuck off in the normative wastelands of your culture, you know. You have your specific parents. They're not archetypal representatives of reality. They're your parents. They're nature and culture, but in finite and flawed human form. And what that means in part is you are raised outside the domain of your culture. It's old. It isn't working very well, and it's not transmitted very well to you. So you grow up outside of it. You're alienated from it. That's that existential alienism. But people have always felt existential alienation. People have always felt alienated from their damn culture because it's old and it's sort of blind. And there you are, young and dynamic and full of life, and all it's doing is telling you you can do this and you can't do that, and, you know, lying to you about some things and doing a pretty nasty job of others. And so you're outside it, you know, and you're alienated from it. And that's what happens to Horus. He's outside in the underworld. That's where he gets born. And so that's worth thinking about, too. Anyways, he grows up. Now, Horus is an interesting sort of character. So you've all seen the image of the Egyptian eye, right? Everyone knows that image, even now, which is pretty cool. So it's got an eyebrow, and it's got an eye in the middle, and then it's got the iris, and usually the pupil is so big that it covers the whole iris. And there's a variety of reasons for that, but one of the reasons is that symbolizes interest and attention. So when you're interested in something, your pupil grows. And so Horus's pupil is really big, and he's checking things out like mad. So Horus is the eye, and he's also a falcon. And you might say, well, why is he a falcon? And the answer to that is, falcons are birds of prey, and they can really see. So that's another amplification of the idea of the eye. Now, falcons fly up above everything, even above the pyramids, and they can see wherever they want to see. And so Horus is the thing that flies up above the structures of mankind, in some sense, and can see them panoramically. So he's not encapsulated in any particular pyramid. He's the thing that's above all pyramids and looking and providing you with an overview. All right. So, and I think the best way to conceptualize Horus in modern terms is attention. That's not thought. That's a whole different thing. Like, attention is what thought... attention is the precursor to thought, in a sense. Attention is where you meet meaning. That's another way of thinking about it, you know? Attention is actually where you take undifferentiated chaos and start to turn it into order. And you think about, how much do you like being paid attention to? People love that. Children, like, you don't pay attention to them, they become pathological. You don't pay attention to your partner, your relationship dissolves. No one pays attention to you, you crawl off in a corner and die. Advertisers pay for your attention. Like, attention, that's a currency, man. That's value. So, you know, and you like to be paid attention to when you do good things, and maybe you'll even do terrible things so that someone pays attention to you. Attention's a big deal. We don't understand it very well. But anyways, the Egyptians conceptualized it as a god. That's smart. That's a very smart idea. Anyways, Horus grows up in the underworld. And then, you know, when he gets kind of big and ready to contend with the world, he thinks, I'm going to take the damn state back from my evil uncle. Well, that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to grow up, pay attention, get yourself the hell out of the underworld, and then take your state back from your evil uncle. Okay, so what happens? So Horus, he gets himself all prepared, and he's, you know, he's son of order and chaos, man. He's no second-rate character. You remember, how many of you have seen the Avengers movies? Okay, so there's, I think it's Samuel Jackson, right? Now, Samuel Jackson is often in the background. And if I remember correctly, he's kind of like the mediator between these shadowy figures that sort of exist as, I don't know, they all look like middle-aged white men, and they're sort of like a power group, and they communicate on screen. I don't know exactly who they are, but Jackson plays an intermediary. But he is lacking an eye. And part of the reason you infer that Jackson is lacking an eye is because he's had a pretty long history of being involved in catastrophe. And, you know, one consequence of that is that he's become damaged. Well, the same thing happens to Horus. So Horus goes back and he says to Seth, I see you for who you are. I know what you're up to. You're working for destruction. You want to take the state apart. There's nothing positive about what you're doing. You facilitate deception. So I'm taking the state back. So they have a big fight. And during the fight, Seth tears out one of Horus's eyes. Now that's worth thinking about too, because what it means, and this is exactly right, you know, one of the things Jung said about encountering malevolence is, like, let's say that you wanted to understand what the Nazis did. And so you started to take it apart, you know, and at each little bit of exploration, you take it apart a little bit more deeply, and then a little bit more deeply, and then a little bit more deeply. You want to get to the bottom of it. Well, you might ask yourself, well, what's at the bottom of terrible things? Well, the answer to that, an answer to that, is the archetype of evil. And if you are to the degree that you encounter that, even if you're capable of godlike attention, which is the case of Horus, the probability is that that will be so devastating that it will destroy half your consciousness. That's what happens to Horus. And so, like, that's another thing I really like about the myths, man. They don't mess around. Like, you're supposed to come out of the underworld. You're supposed to see what the hell's going on. You're supposed to go back and take the state away from its archaic institutions and willful blindness. But if you really contend with that, you better look out, because you're contending with something that you can barely master. Anyways, Horus beats Seth, despite the fact that he has his eye torn out. And so then he tells Seth to go outside the boundaries of the kingdom and to never come back. Well, why doesn't he kill him? Well, you can't. He's a god. You can't get rid of Seth. Seth is the deity of the decomposition of states. That's not going away. The best you can do is hold it at bay for periods of time. And you have to be awake and aware of its constant presence. Anyways, he chases Seth away, but he gets his eye back. And so he reclaims his consciousness from malevolence, essentially. And then you might think, okay, well, what should he do? He should slap that eye back in his head, and then, you know, he's defeated evil, so now he should be king. And that would be a good ending to the story. But that isn't what the Egyptians do. And this is where they really get brilliant, in my estimation. So Horus takes his eye, and he goes back to the underworld. So he does this voluntarily. He goes back to the underworld. And he goes back to where Osiris is existing, because it's sort of the land of the dead. And so Osiris has this weird existence. He's scattered all over Egypt, but his essence, I suppose, his spirit, is down there in the underworld, which is, it's not exactly hell. Hell is a suburb of the underworld. Like, it's the worst neighborhood of the underworld. That's a good way of thinking about it. You guys go to the underworld fairly often. You may take a rare side trip to hell, and you probably regret it. But, and we can talk about what that means, because it actually has a very specific meaning. Anyways, Osiris isn't in hell, he's just in the underworld, so he's sitting there sort of, you know, inactive and in rough shape. So Horus goes down to the underworld, and he finds Osiris, and he gives him an eye. And so then Osiris can see again. Remember, he couldn't see. He was willfully blind, right? And so that's partly what led to his demise. So Horus gives him this eye that's been hard fought, right? It's the eye with which he encountered evil. He gives Osiris that eye. It perks him right up. And so then Horus and Osiris go back to the surface world, and they unite to form the ruler of Egypt. And so the idea is that The proper ruler is obviously the thing that can pay attention and conquer the pathology of the state and willful blindness, but it's more than that. It's the thing that does that and then rejuvenates the state. And, you know, one of the things, I think this is quite interesting, so the hippie culture in the 1960s was a revolutionary culture, and you can make a case that during the 60s and the latter part of the 50s, that people, young people's attention was very much focused on certain pathological elements of the state. You know, the civil rights movement seemed to be a real thing. There was a movement towards the emancipation of women. There were lots of things that I think you can look at from a distance and say, you know, good work. But then there was the other element of it, which was, well, you know, down with the state and don't trust anyone over 30. Well, that's kind of stupid because, first of all, you know, it's not that long till you're 30, and then what do you do? And second, it's like, well, no, you can't throw the damn baby out with the bathwater. I mean, first of all, you're probably doing that because you don't want to grow up ever. You're just Peter Pan. And second, it's like, you can't leave Osiris languishing in the underworld. You have to give him vision and bring him back up to the surface, because I don't care how attentive you are. If you're also not wise, you're not going to be good for anything. And the wisdom is partly the integration of the best your culture has to offer you into your character so that you can be an avatar of culture, an attentive avatar of culture. And then you're a well-balanced soul. Well, so the Egyptians figured all this out. And then it's even cooler than that because they used this idea of the union of Horus and Osiris as their conceptual representation of what gave the pharaoh sovereignty. Which is, because again, like the Mesopotamians, they were trying to figure out, well, what should rule? You know, what should be above all? And the Mesopotamians figured, well, it's something like Marduk. He's got lots of eyes, he can talk, he's brave, he'll conquer the unknown, he makes things as a consequence, he makes a pretty good top god. And the Egyptians added a level of sophistication to that, because Horus is not only the thing that will go into the underworld. He goes into the underworld and he rescues things of tremendous value and then unites with them so that not only can he see, but he's wise. And so then that's what the pharaoh was supposed to be. And the Egyptians basically characterized that union as something akin to the immortal soul. Now, Iliad attracts this development he called the democratization of Osiris. So first of all, basically, only the pharaoh was allowed to be the Horus-Osiris union in some sense, you know. So, and in a way, he was God on earth, you know, and which is a conception, of course, that's lasted into cultures for a very, very long period of time. The Japanese still thought that way about their emperor until the end of World War II, and many of them still think that way. So he was the embodiment of divine sovereignty. It was in the leader only. But as the Egyptian state developed, the idea that that soul was an attribute started to descend down the power hierarchy. So after a while, the aristocracy started to use it. And then, now, and this is a radical oversimplification, but it'll do for the purposes of this discussion. You know, by the time the Jews came along, and they came out of Egypt, mythologically speaking, the idea that there could be a union or a relationship between something that was divine and something that was individual was distributed a long ways down the power hierarchy. You know, and then by the time the Greeks showed up, well, in some sense it was all males, at least all males who were part of the polity, and then when the Christians emerged, it was everyone. Prostitutes, tax collectors, thieves, murderers, everyone. And so the idea of sovereignty started to become, you know, first of all, it was a mythological attribute that was identified with the ruler, but then it became a psychological attribute that was distributed across the entire population. It's brilliant. It's brilliant. And as far as I can tell, that's really, those conceptualizations form the substructure of our belief that each person is divinely valuable, you know, in their own right, that they have inalienable rights, even if you're a murderer, right? The state is very restricted in what it can do to you, even if you've committed a terrible crime, even if you admit to it, the state is still very restricted in what it's allowed to do to you, because there's an idea that there's something about you that has the quality of transcendent value. That's exactly it. And, well, and we know some of the attributes, you know. One of them is that you can see and pay attention. The other is that you can speak and communicate. You know, the other is that you can become wise, that you can approach things that frighten you with courage and generate new information as a consequence. Like, there's lots of things about you that the relationship between chaos and order actually literally depend upon. And so the state has come to respect the individual, partly because the individual is, by necessity, the thing that rejuvenates the state. And so there's this dynamic relationship between the two. The state structures you, but it's old and blind, and there's lots of things it can't see, and it's partly corrupt. Okay, but it's a hell of a lot better than nothing, generally speaking. And so then you're like the forerunner of the state, and you can pay attention, and maybe you can see where things aren't working exactly right, where they're not working properly, and fix them. And so then the state maintains its protective structure across time, and you exist in a dialectical relationship with it. You know, you see, by the time the Christian hero mythology emerges, Christ is more the reconstructor of the state than he is the thing that encounters chaos, right? Because a huge chunk of the Christian story is about the antagonism between him and his culture and the Roman culture as well. So the whole existential drama actually shifts from, you know, hero as buttress against nature, which of course would have been the case earlier, to hero as thing that decomposes and reconstructs culture in a radical way. So, you know, Moses does the same thing. It's another, and Moses is a master of water. He's a transformative agent, so it's an indication of exactly the same sort of idea. Well, it's a good time for a break. Who owned the factory? And she didn't ask him any real questions, you know, because what she did instead was caricaturize him even a priori as sort of, you know, a fascist capitalist, sort of like the millionaire in Monopoly, and never tried to get beneath the superficial a priori categorization to find out what the hell he actually thought. And I was just waiting. I thought, okay, well, this is cool. What the hell does the factory owner have to say? It's like, where does money go? Why does he think he has a right to the factory? Like, what are his conditions of ownership? Did he earn the money? What, did he inherit it? It's like, what does he think about the fact that Argentina's economy has collapsed? How does he feel about the fact that all these workers are out of work? What does he think about the fact that they opened up the factory again? Like, there's a lot of interesting things to ask this guy. None of it. None of it happened. And so, to me, what happened was that she was like someone with neglect. You know, she was looking at the world, but she could only see half of everything. And the half she saw was probably perfectly, you know, justifiable, had its proper domain of application. But the half she missed, it's like, well, what about that part of the story? You're going to reduce that to cliche and stereotype and expand up the rest of the story? Well, the only reason you do that is if you didn't want to find out what the hell was going on, if you all you wanted to do was gather evidence that would support your initial theory. Now, I know perfectly well that there's plenty of situations where workers, the conditions of workers, are absolutely abysmal. I mean, one of the books I've read that's, I think, a remarkable documentation of that fact is a book by George Orwell called Road to Wigan Pier, which is a study of the conditions that coal miners lived in 1930s in Britain. And, you know, it's bloody dismal. And the idea that they were exploited, it's, well, that's a tougher one, because the Industrial Revolution was very, very hard on people. And it was really, really hard on some people, you know, particularly on some people. Whether that was because of exploitation or because of the existence of absolute poverty is not all that obvious. And, you know, so it's a complicated issue. Now, there's lots of times when workers were clearly exploited, but I think there were times as well when they weren't. Anyways, it's a great book, and, you know, he does a lovely job of laying out a rationale for why the workers should be treated far better than they were treated. And, you know, so fine, good, wonderful. There's something to be said But the thing is, when you want to say something, you want to take an unbiased sample if you can. And so this is why I like this particular mode of conceptualization. And I think it's, the reason I think it's not an intellectual construction is because I think it emerges naturally out of the structure of mythology and narrative. And you can think this through yourself, but as far as I've been able to tell, narratives present themselves in terms of archetypal characters. And the thing about a comprehensive narrative is it can't leave out an archetypal character, or it fails. Now, I can give you an example of this, okay? So, how many of you have seen Disney's Sleeping Beauty? Okay, so many of you have. How many haven't? Okay, so there's a few that haven't. Well, the Disney movies, you know, they're kind of standard childhood fare. Now, in Sleeping Beauty, what happens is that the king and queen give birth to a princess after trying for a substantial amount of time. And, you know, she arrives healthy and beautiful, and then they have a christening day, and they invite everybody to it, but they don't invite Maleficent, who's a dark witch, roughly speaking. You know, like she's queen of the underworld, that for lack of a better word. She's the negative element of femininity. And they don't invite her to the party. And so she shows up anyways and says that because they didn't invite her, their daughter's going to die when she hits 16, which is, you know, roughly the age of, let's say, sexual maturation for a story of that sort. Now, there's another little positive magic female in the story who mitigates that death sentence to protracted sleep. Well, the idea behind it, it's a very, very interesting story. It's an Oedipal story in a sense, because what it says is that if your parents protect you too much from the dark side of life when you're young, that what will happen when you start to on the road to maturity is you'll be so naive and so fragile that you'll want to be unconscious instead of paying attention, and that you're going to have to be rescued from that state by something. And it could be a prince, which is how that story lays itself out, or it also could be the symbolically masculine and exploratory element of your own psyche. And the stories are ambivalent about whether it's an external event or an internal event. It doesn't really matter. You know, the things end up being the same. And so that's actually what happens in the Sleeping Beauty story. You know, at the end, a prince who's also enslaved by this terrible negative feminine force manages to escape, and the Maleficent turns into a dragon, and he has to fight her, and then he goes and rescues the princess, and she wakes up, and the kingdom's rejuvenated, and everybody's happy. It's a classic, classic story. You know, and it's not, it's funny, because the Disney movie Frozen was put forward as a, in some sense, as a feminist alternative to the classic fairy tales, and first of all, you can't do that. You can't just generate up a fairy tale. You know, there's recent evidence that some of these fairy tales, the ones that the Grimm brothers and Hans Christian Andersen collected, are up to 10,000 years old. You can't just come up with a counter fairy tale. That's just not how it works. And the way that fairy tale is structured, it has nothing to do with the necessity for anyone to rely on anyone else for anything. It's a complex portrayal of the dynamic relationship between archetypal characters. And, you know, it's one form of the story. There's lots of different forms of the story. But what I like about Sleeping Beauty, for example, and this is what's nice about the real fairy tales, is that along with the positive, there's negative, and it's real negative. Like, real fairy tales are terrifying. Like, who is it? Is it in Sleeping Beauty? Or in Snow White? I don't remember. In one of the famous Grimm fairy tales, one of the evil sisters ends up dancing in red hot shoes till she dies. You know, they're very, very violent and unsettling. And it's because they, you know, they have the quality of genuine folk tales. But the reason for that is because they're dealing with real things. Like the Hansel and Gretel story is a good example of that, right? Kids are abandoned out in the woods. They find something that's too good to be true. Inside this thing that's too good to be true is something that wants to fatten them up and devour them. It's a rough story. But what it's doing, the stories have evolved to represent the fundamental dynamic elements of existence. If you conceptualize existence in terms of character, and the thing is, you have to conceptualize existence in terms of character if you're a person, because what you do in existence is act out your character. You didn't get to call yourself a Marxist anymore, although there were still people, and you still see them, saying, well, that wasn't real Marxism, which I think is a cop-out of staggering proportions. It usually means, well, if I was the person running the country, that wouldn't have happened. You know, that's the logic behind it. They didn't put the principles into practice properly. It's like, yeah, well, lots of people put the damn principles into practice, and the same thing happened everywhere. So at some point, you have to kind of wonder if there's something wrong with the principles. Anyways, what Foucault did was take the Marxist presupposition that everything was could be boiled down to economics and economic power, and translated it into the idea that everything just boiled down to power. You know, and that the reason that we have institutions is to include and to exclude, and that the institutions always run for the benefit of those at the top. It's like, well, yeah, that's a little bit true, but it's, you know, it's a scientist would look at that and say, yeah, well, probably, you know, power dynamics in a functioning economic and political system maybe account for 10% of the variance, something like that, maybe 15%. So, for example, if you have a, say you want to go to an Ivy League school, well, if your parents went to the school, you're more likely to get in, but you're not that much more likely to get in, and you still have to be, you know, roughly speaking, what happens is that if you have a pretty decent, you know, high school GPA, and you do very well on the SATs, and you have some other talents of some sort, because that's also necessary, then they might pick you over someone else who's roughly equally qualified if you have a familial history of attendance at the school. So obviously you get an advantage, but it's not the kind of advantage that accounts for the entirety of how the system is structured. It's an advantage. Well, you can say, well, that's not fair. It's like, yeah, okay. Fair enough. Most systems are certainly not 100% either fair or just. Definitely not. But, you know, instead of comparing them to utopia, you might compare them to another system, which is the only reasonable way to do it. It's like everything looks terrible when you compare it to the best thing you can possibly imagine. But the best thing you can possibly imagine is it's an empty fiction, because it's so devoid of detailed content that you can't use it as a guide to reality. Now, I mean, the idea that things could be better has its roots in some sense in a broad-scale utopian project, and I believe that things could be better, but that doesn't mean that when you're doing an analysis of a complex system, you get to compare it to an ideological utopia and then describe all the reasons that it's bad. It's not appropriate to do that. It's too simplistic. You're not going to do anything to actually address the problems that the system has if you take that approach. And then, of course, like pure utopian thinking is extraordinarily dangerous, because if you think that your way of molding society into some ultimate state of perfection is headed towards some ultimate state of perfection, then you can justify absolutely anything you do right now on the basis of the fact that things are going to improve so radically in the future. And that means any of your behaviors are excused. The end is worth it. Well, if someone says that, you have to kind of wonder what they're actually planning. Excuse me. What they're actually planning to do. Okay, what's the issue? Well, the issue is that it's... So the same critic with regards to Foucault, he said, you know, it's basically the same thing, that Foucault criticized a variety of low, you know, profound institutions, sexual institutions, say, like marriage, and then institutions of power like prisons and institutions of mental health, you know, the whole institutional framework. He criticized them on the basis of power and exclusion, and you could do that, and there's some truth in it. But, you know, Foucault also made the presupposition. The problem with that presupposition is that everything is about something else, is that it's almost impossible to see how it can't be applied to Foucault himself. So you'd have to ask, if you were a student of Foucault, what power aims drove his attempt to analyze everything in terms of power. And I actually think with Foucault it's pretty obvious. So, but it's a game that never goes anywhere. Okay, so I thought about that a lot. It's like, is there any system that you can develop that doesn't have the negative consequences of systems in general? And then if that is possible, how and why might it be possible? And this is partly why I'm talking to you about this particular diagram again. And I think the reason, now I don't know this, and you guys can think it through yourself. I mean, lots of people have talked to me about the content of this course, and you know, they've said that it's been very helpful for them when it comes to interpreting certain elements of their life, you know. But some people have said, well, it's just another system. And I don't believe that. I think it's a meta system. And I don't think the rules that apply to systems also apply to meta systems. But, you know, that could just be me. So you're going to have to decide that for yourself. But I think the reason that I can make that claim, and that it's a valid claim, is because, first of all, I don't believe it's an intellectual system. I don't think it's an attempt to reduce a complex set of phenomena to something that is, what, dispenses with important elements of their existence. Like, so for example, let me give you an example of how that sort of thing happens. Like, if you're looking at the world through a biased lens, what it means is you take non-random samples of the environmental data. So I can give you a quick example of something I saw that I thought was very particular in that regard. I don't think I've used this example before, but about 10 years ago or thereabouts, Naomi Klein made a documentary about this factory down in South America. I believe it was in Argentina. And this was just after all the foreign capital fled out of Argentina and the economy collapsed completely, which is something that happens to Argentina fairly regularly, by the way. And she went down there to this factory where there were working men, and they had been building heavy machinery, and the working men decided that they were going to, the factory had been padlocked, and they had been locked out because things had come to a halt. And they decided that they were going to take the chains off the factory gate and go in there and start making heavy machinery again. And, you know, it was a very cool documentary as far as I was concerned. She went down there and she interviewed all these working guys, and you know, they talked about how their lives had been brought to a halt by the factory closure. And obviously it sucked that they were sitting around doing nothing and not being paid for anything when they could have been inside the factory building heavy machinery, which is what they wanted to do. So she went down there and laid out their story, and it was very sympathetic to the workers, and good, you know, fair enough, good. But then she went and interviewed the guy. So your character is an element of existence. Now, you might say, well, that doesn't mean that society has a character. But actually, it does mean that. And because partly what happens, like, if you're socialized, say, into a culture, the culture exists in the same relationship to you, roughly speaking, as another person does. So, for example, if you put money in the bank, which is, in principle, a representation of your labor, what you're doing is entering into a contract with the broader social world, which is one of promise, essentially, where the future society promises to return your value at a future date. So it's a contractual relationship. And the reason that God the Father is a very common representation is because treating the they in Heideggerian terms, the others in Heideggerian terms, as if they're an embodied entity actually works. So it's because it is an emergent property of all of the personalities that make it up. And so you're interacting with that emergent personality all the time. You could even say, for example, that that's the Freudian id. It's the thing that the representation of that inside you is what makes you feel guilty when you transgress against certain moral rules. And you might say, along with the radical existentialists, that that's just arbitrary and that you can create your own values. But it's not just arbitrary, because it's dependent on the consent of others as well as on some internal harmony or disharmony. It's not arbitrary. And you can't just set that up by yourself. So, you know, these things are realities, and they're deep realities. Now, this particular portrayal indicates a kind of balance. So the fundamental ground of reality is neither positive nor negative. It's the ground out of which everything positive or negative emerges. So you might think of the fundamental ground of reality as that which exists prior to your encounter with it. And we have no idea what that is. Now you can think about it as, you can think about it as, people tend to think about what things are made of in atomic terms, but it's not a particularly comprehensive way of thinking about it, because what exists beyond the realm of your comprehension is the patterned relationship between everything and everything. And you can't reduce it to any simple level of analysis, because you miss all sorts of elements of it that are extraordinarily important if you do that. So you can't do that. That's not what experience is made out of, you know, or what the ground of experience is made out of. And so it's neutral in some sense, because it exists beyond your encounter with it. It's the unknown as such. And the reason that that's often represented in the form of a predatory lizard that has something to offer is precisely because of that. It's like the absolute unknown has the capacity to tear you into pieces and burn you up, but it also has the possibility of rewarding you with everything you could possibly be rewarded with. So it's this strange juxtaposition of potential. I like to think about it as potential, you know, because people can get a grip on what potential means. There's potential everywhere, whatever that is. You have potential. Your parents tell you that all the time. What is that? Well, it's the unrealized stuff of your being. Now, it's a very strange concept, potential, because you can't characterize it any way that you would characterize something that's real, because it's not real, it's potential. But you act like it's real. You know, you'll feel guilty that you're not living up to your potential, you're not manifesting your potential. You want people to interact with you so that they allow you to demonstrate your potential. Like, you act as if it's a reality continually. You think as if it's a reality continually. You ask if your relationship has potential, you know. But it's a very, very strange substance, whatever this potential is. It's unrealized possibility, essentially. But you regard it as something that's fluid and something that can develop in all sorts of different directions, and something whose development you can shape. Because otherwise, why would you feel guilty? It's like, you know, if you're doing the wrong thing, you're realizing some potential in the wrong way. And then you feel bad about that. It's like, well, there's some sense of intrinsic morality operating at the bottom of that. We've talked a lot about that. Some of that's built in biologically. Some of it's, you know, structured culturally. Some of it's a consequence of you trying to, you know, trying to organize this plethora of semi-beings that you are into some integrated manner. Like, it's a very, very complicated thing. And it's not just arbitrary. Okay, so that's the very background, the dragon of chaos, positive and negative, and it's the thing out of which everything springs. If you look at the Scandinavian world tree, for example, or world trees in general, you very frequently have a representation of a serpent that's associated with them. And the reason that that potential is regarded as serpentine is extraordinarily complicated, but I think it's partly because snakes shed their own skin, and so they can be reborn, so they're a symbol of transformation. And then they're sneaky and subtle, and so they appear in places you wouldn't necessarily expect them to. And then they're a terrible, terrible threat. But in overcoming that threat, you also develop. So not only are they a threat, but they're the kind of threat that makes you become strong while you face it. So that's partly why the snake is such an ambivalent figure in most mythology. So, okay, so that's complicated, but we'll return to that later. And then out of that, you might say, emerges the unknown as you encounter it. So there's potential itself, and then the first layer of potential are the things that you encounter that you don't understand. So I can give you an example of that. So let's say you're a 3-year-old or 2-year-old, that's better, and you're in your kitchen and a mouse runs across the room. And so you track it because, you know, your eyes pick up the movement. Then you track the thing. And then it's an unexpected occurrence, so you don't know what it signifies, right? So that's the emergence of something tangibly unknown into your conceptual space. Now, it's like, not like you lack any knowledge of it. You can tell that what its size is, and you can get some estimation of its speed. You know, and I think that what you have to do when you think about whether or not something is unknown is you have to think about it in relationship to that hierarchy of perception that I keep throwing at you. You know, if something emerges, if you encounter an entity and you can map it at every single level of your value hierarchy, then it's known. You know how to interact with it at a micro level, and you know what its implications are for every other level of your conceptual being. You know what its implications are for the future. Like, you know exactly how to deal with that thing. It's mapped at every single level. There's other things that are only mapped at one level and not at others. So maybe, you know, you like the mouse, we'll say, for the child who's never seen a mouse, it's like it shares some commonalities with objects that the child is familiar with. But there's sufficient novelty so that it's also contaminated with the unknown. And that makes the child basically alert, semi-startled and alert. Now, the child will immediately refer to an adult. It's a technical term, actually. They'll look at the adult's face because the adult's face will broadcast the motivational and affective significance of that event. And so the child looks, references, and then reads off the face and, of course, the speech and the bodily actions exactly what that thing signifies, you know, and then if the person that they're looking at jumps up on the table and screams, then that's one set of meanings, which is, God, this thing is magical. It's only this big. And look at what effect it has on, you know, my aunt, for the sake of argument, who's, you know, a pretty competent creature, as far as I can tell, being 2 years old. You know, and then if she just dismisses it, you know, her actions are going to determine the meaning of that phenomenon. So that's how the transformation of the semi known thing into the more known thing occurs. It occurs almost always in a social context. You can explore things by yourself, but you rarely actually do that by yourself. It's almost always you plugged into a social apparatus, you know. So you might be doing the specific investigating, but the social apparatus is around you so that you can confer with it, and it also shapes the way that you're going to interact with that specific thing. Okay, so the unknown, that's generally, that the unknown that you encounter, that's generally characterized using feminine symbolism. And I think the reason for that, there's a bunch of reasons, and we've talked about many of them. One reason is because females do the sexual selection in human beings, and so they act as the face of nature. Another reason is that you can think of new possibility always emerging out of the non-cultural background in some sense, you know. So, for example, let's say that we send an expedition to Mars and we're gathering new information as a consequence. The reason we're gathering new information is because we've gone out past the domain of our knowledge, in a sense, and we're interacting with something new. And in that interaction, new information is generated. Now, you can say that it's partly the act of the perceiver that's generating the new information, and you can say that it's partly the act of the culture, because we send robots to Mars, let's say, which is very, very difficult. So the culture goes there, but the individuals are observing. So the individuals are buttressed by the culture, but they're generating information because they're somewhere truly new. And so the information, you know, the unknown is a constant source of new information. So it's the place that gives birth to new information. And so that's another part of the reason that it seems to be symbolized in feminine form. You know, I'm just taking this in some sense as an empirical fact. I've looked at, it looks like that's how these stories work. And so I've been trying to puzzle out why exactly that would be the case. You know, I also think it's the case that we tend to look at the world from a social cognitive perspective, right? We filter it through a social cognitive biological apparatus, and so we're very likely to see things in character form, and characters have sexes, And so that's going to happen. And then which, the attributes of femininity or the attributes of masculinity that get used as symbolic reference, in some sense, there's an arbitrariness about it. So, for example, for the Egyptians, you know, usually you have a sky god, but they had a sky goddess. Now, she generally represent the night sky, which is not exactly the same thing as the day sky. But, you know, you have to, it's so tricky because you have to look at the relationships between the characters in order to decide what all of them mean. And that shifts a little bit from story to story. So this is a, what would you say? It's an approximation of the underlying structure, but there's a fair bit of variance in it, just like there's variation in stories. So, well, the feminine element has a destructive element and a creative aspect. And you can see that people characterize their environments in that way. So, for example, you can map on environmental beliefs onto this structure. You can say that the environmentalist portrays nature as positive, portrays culture as negative, and portrays the individual as negative. And the basic story is rampaging individual as member of rapacious culture invading the pristine landscape of beautiful Mother Nature. Now, the thing about that story is it's true. The problem with the story is it's half true. Now, so for example, one thing that's interesting to conceptualize is that that's exactly the opposite of the frontier myth. Now, the frontier myth was a story that was used extensively in Europe to drive immigration into the United States, and it was used to some degree in Canada too, and the story was the exact opposite. It's the hero, so that would be the immigrant, pioneer, bringing the benefits of order to a savage wilderness. Well, that's also true. But it's so interesting that both of those things can be true, and they're completely different from one another. There's no commonality at all between those two stories, except for the way that they use the characters. There's a feminine character, a masculine character that represents culture, and then there's another character that represents the individual. And you could even see that, if you think about it historically, the U.S. was founded in some sense on a frontier myth. And, you know, that was too one-sided, and so by the time the 1960s came along, the early 1960s, it shifted to its opposite. And that you need that because systems have to oscillate to some degree to remain stable across time. They can't just be fixed in place. So they're going to play back and forth through the archetypes in an attempt to keep them balanced, because that's what you're trying to do. You're trying to keep them balanced. And so, well, you have the destructive and creative element of Mother Nature. You see that all the time in movies where the thing that the hero is striving against is the negative element of the unknown. How many of you have seen the movie Alien? Okay, so, you know, that's a pretty graphic representation of, well, those aliens are more reptilian in form. So they're almost like, They're more at the dragon of chaos level of symbolization. But they're like a terrible external force that's threatening human culture and the individual. It's exactly the opposite story that's played out in, what was the movie with all the blue creatures?
Avatar.
Mm-hmm. Avatar, right. Avatar is exactly the opposite of that, where, you know, the unknown nature is just nothing but, it's like sweetness and bliss, and, you know, And the human culture is portrayed as spearheaded by greedy and rapacious individuals who are basically manifestations of the military-industrial complex. The funny thing is, I want to take another look at this figure to begin with. Now, one of the reasons that I began to think about these sorts of things was because I wanted to understand what it might mean to have a set of values and beliefs, because those two things go together, that would, I guess part of the question was, is it possible to develop a system of belief that's outside of the realm of ideology? You know, because one thing you might claim is that it's all ideology. any belief system is ideological. And if you develop a belief system that criticizes other belief systems, it just means that you've developed a new ideological stance. And there's some, that's a good argument, you know. I can think of a number of ways that it's true. One of the things Nietzsche said in the late 1800s was that if you inhabited a belief system, even a religious system, and you lost faith in it, not only did you lose faith in that system, but you also potentially lost faith in systems themselves. And so it was a meta-collapse in a sense. Not only did you lose your belief, but you lost your belief in beliefs. So you could think of the set of all possible beliefs and then abandoning any hope of relying on those as valid sources of information. So, you know, so that's one perspective, and it's a powerful one. I mean, Nietzsche believed that that was a certain pathway to nihilism, essentially, or perhaps to a reactionary totalitarianism, but it boils down to the same thing. I've been reading this book recently, which the title of I can't remember, unfortunately, but I'll tell it to you after class. It's a critique of certain lines of left-wing ideological thinking, including the existential thought of people like Jean-Paul Sartre and Foucault. And one of the most trenchant critiques of Sartre, because he believes that you sort of have an absolute freedom, that you're destined for freedom, that you're doomed to it in some sense, and that part of your existential journey is to establish an authenticity that's correct for you. But he isn't able really to give any description of what that should be grounded in. And the critic concludes that all Sartre can do is stand outside of any potential belief system and criticize it. And there's nothing in it for anyone as a consequence of that. It's only destructive. Now, it's important to remember with regards to Sartre that he viewed other people to some degree, like the common man, the bourgeoisie, we might say, as the embodiment of non-freedom, of inauthenticity, and also as a barrier to genuine authenticity. So he wasn't willing to give any credence to the utility of normality. But I also think he wasn't able to tolerate the consequences of his own thought, because he was an avid supporter of the Communist Party far after anyone with any reasonable moral sense would have stopped doing that. So Sartre really didn't denounce the Communists until the end of the beginning of the 70s, roughly speaking. He was never a card-carrying Communist, but he was very left-leaning. And, you know, by the 1970s, by the late 60s, by the early 70s, a lot of the evidence about what was going on in Soviet Russia had been in for 30 years, you know. So there was really no excuse for not facing up to that and trying to understand what it meant. And, you know, it would be bad enough if it was just the Soviet Union, but it wasn't. The same sort of thing happened wherever those utopian presuppositions were put into place. And I suppose many of you don't know this, but Pol Pot, who was the Cambodian dictator, was educated at the Sorbonne, and he wrote his thesis on the, he wrote his, I think it was his PhD thesis, although it might have been his master's thesis, on the Marxist doctrine that urban people were parasites on rural people. So he, you know, there's a theory that says that the genuine value is generated purely by labor, and much of that's rural labor, and the cities siphon off excess productive power and are able to parasitize the countryside as a consequence of that, and which is a, you know, tremendously non-productive theory. But Pol Pot put it into practice, and so when he went back into Cambodia, he chased everybody out of the cities and killed about 6 million people. So, you know, you can read about that if you want. It's a pretty appalling section of 20th century history, you know, especially when it's the case that he was educated in the West and had these presuppositions drummed into him. Well, then there's Foucault, who I have no respect for, by the way. I think I've read a fair bit of Foucault, and I think everything he says is obvious. So, for example, he criticizes the idea of mental illness as a social construct. It's like, well, yeah, obviously. I mean, it's not like psychiatrists and psychologists and mental health professionals who are relatively well informed haven't known about that since for the last 60 years. I mean, it might be a revelation to people who don't notice that psychiatry, for example, is something like a compromise between the patient, biology, and the social world. You know, I mean, psychiatric ailments often have a biological tilt, but the way they manifest themselves in society is clearly conditioned in very intense ways by the particular conditions obtaining at the point that the person who has that biological predisposition exists. Even whether or not that's pathological can be tilted one way or another by cultural norms. And then, of course, when you're dealing with issues like insurance payment and treatment and hospitalization, obviously you're pulling in all sorts of systems that are by no means purely scientific, but I don't find it a particularly useful critique. It's obvious as far as I'm concerned. And the other thing that Foucault did, I mean, I think this is the typical, especially the French intellectuals' typical sleight of hand once Marxism became, you know, once you were no longer able to call yourself a committed Marxist, because committed Marxism had led to unbelievable brutality, you know, on a scale that had never probably, I think, had never been experienced in the entire history of the planet, at least in terms of its reach and duration.